electric vehicle performance attributes. When we talk about electric vehicle performance attributes, the point is, I mean, when we look at the complete vehicle development, you have had battery and fuel cells, the electric powertrain. You can talk about the electrics, the electronics. But when we look at a vehicle as such and having it like acceptable for the general public, an important element is to make sure that all the different aspects of the vehicle, the detailed aspects, are also covered. And this means things like energy and thermal management, which is obviously very important for an electric vehicle, but also those aspects that you may not think of immediately, such as the noise and vibration, the durability, the driving dynamics. All these elements make a good vehicle a good vehicle. And so they need to be addressed specifically. Let me start with what we would call energy management. Now, energy management for sure is looked at in a very global context. And you have all the different aspects of the vehicle working together, and you need to manage the energy transfers between components, the cooling systems, and so on. But what I want to talk about here is more the details of these things. Yeah? When you look at the global energy management, you look at how much cooling does an electric motor or the battery need. But in the end, it's also things like the air conditioning system. You have to make it comfortable for the people inside the vehicle. And in an electric vehicle, that's not so evident because you don't have a engine there that is your source of heat. You need to get your heat in a different way. And sometimes when you're in a cold climate, you need to decide whether you're going to heat the battery first and then the passengers, or make a balance between that. And also detailed aspects, just as the defrosting of the windshield. Yeah? It's things that need to be looked at, and they need to be looked at in detail. So what we need to do is look at energy consumption for the different areas of the vehicle in detail, starting off with, let's say, less detail, obviously, when you are in the concept phase. But as you gradually go through the vehicle development, you need to look at the details of heat exchangers, for example, how they are configured, where they are put in the vehicle. And those details that you are working out on this heat exchanger level, they need to be integrated in your global picture, which means that in our solutions that we've been putting in place is, for example, detailed 3D CFD calculations can immediately be linked with a 1D system level model in order to evaluate the performance of that system. It also brings us the capabilities to investigate new cooling strategies, like, for example, here with Samsung in India, where a completely new strategy for cooling the battery is being looked at. And this is modeled then in the context with STARS DCM Plus. You get details, but again, these details need to be worked into a system level model such that you can, for example, have your thermal management system for the entire vehicle covered. And in that sense, I mentioned it already, linking 3D with 1D simulation models. Here with Mitsubishi, it's a nice example where you see the entire network of the cooling system connected to a 3D model of the underhood of the vehicle. This is for a hybrid electric vehicle. It allows to look at how the thermal behavior under the hood, how that is happening, but at the same time have the complete system linked to that. So that's for thermal management systems. Another aspect is, for example, aerodynamics of the vehicle. Aerodynamics, yes, that's your drag. Of course, very important, because more drag is more energy loss. You want to avoid that. But you also want to, for example, manage the driving dynamics. When you have a side wind on a car, aerodynamics, that's one part of it. But you must also take into account the driving dynamics along with that. And not to forget, even more detailed analysis, like, for example, the water and dirt management, your windscreen wipers, and in the context of what will be autonomous vehicles, How do I keep my sensors clean? These are all aspects that we need to take into account. Nice example in this context we have with Mercedes-Benz. You have this shape-changing vehicle that they made as a concept car that was developed with Star CCM and, of course, also in the wind tunnel, but also in race teams. When we look at the Formula E, the cars that are driving in there, it's not just the aerodynamics, it's also aesthetics that is important. A race car needs to look cool, and those things come together. And at the same time, you need to manage not just the aerodynamics, but also how flow of air is going through the vehicle in terms of cooling systems. So that's another element there. So that's energy management, aerodynamics. We can go into a lot of detail there. We don't have time for that today, so let's leave it at that. Let's go to a second aspect, which is very near to our hearts, because we at Siemens, we have 40 years plus of experience in noise and vibration. And people say, noise and vibration for electric vehicles, is that important? Because the electric motor is quieter. Yes, that's true, but we have to look at the whole thing. You know, with a combustion engine vehicle, we used to have a lot of powertrain noise, and that noise, and that was the focus of our analysis. But now with electric vehicles, we see road noise, we see wind noise, we see noise coming from all kinds of ancillary systems, and they contribute a lot to what is the total noise of the system. I mean, when you are driving down the road and you hear your air conditioning system, that's uncomfortable. It doesn't make you feel comfortable in the vehicle. It gives you an impression of bad quality. And that's where there is a lot of work to be done on the electric vehicle side. If we look at that a little bit in detail, I mean, when you're sitting in your car and you used to drive with a combustion engine vehicle, you hear that rumbling in the front or in the rear if you have maybe a very nice sports car. But that noise from the engine was there, and it sort of masked a lot of the unwanted noises. It gave you sort of like a comfort cushion, that noise. Now, what we get is these tonal high frequency elements that come from the electric drive units due to not just the gearbox, which is mechanical, but also the pulse width modulation system that drives the electric motor. Those chopping frequencies at which it works, that can be 8 kilohertz, 10 kilohertz, but you can hear them and they can be very annoying. And now when we go to a hybrid motor or a hybrid drive system where the combustion engine might kick in every once in a while to recharge the battery, that can create transient phenomena that are quite uncomfortable, not necessarily high in level, but these things can be quite uncomfortable. And one of the conclusions that comes from that is that when we look at electric vehicle noise, the focus should not be on the sound level. We've been for years, for decades, looking at sound level in terms of NVH behavior. Now we need to look at sound metrics. Sound metrics meaning what is the sound quality of the car. I want to highlight also on the right-hand side of this slide is a different concept or something that plays into the whole NVH behavior of a car. When you know that electric vehicles are going to be developed with a huge number of new variants on the market in the near future, when we're talking about Volkswagen going to develop 70 new cars in the next 7 years, that's 10 cars per year on average. These are not, of course, not going to be built from the ground up. They're going to be built based on modular components. And so one of the things that we've been looking at in this sense is to be able to characterize components, subsystems of a vehicle, let's say air conditioning systems, wiper systems, steering systems, even suspension systems, be able to characterize them separately as modules on test benches, and then virtually assemble them, assess how the combination will work, how they will work together, and evaluate the total noise. And we do this now for booming noise, for road noise. We can do it for pass-by noise even. And we go as far as being able to listen to the noise of this assembled vehicle in a driving simulator. And when we talk about the driving simulator and assessing a noise, we have to also think of what are the options or the possibilities that an electric vehicle brings us. Since the level is relatively low, it brings us the possibility to, for example, add noise to the vehicle. There is the legislation in place that makes you add noise in terms of exterior noise because of pedestrians that need to hear the vehicle. And when an electric vehicle is driving slowly, it is very quiet outside. Yes, so we need to put in place AVAS systems, the audible vehicle alert systems. But the same techniques that are there to develop these kind of noises on the exterior, you can also apply to the interior. So you could say, I have a baseline vehicle and I want to add something. I can add what would be called a soundscape to the vehicle that creates an ambient where you could use it to mask some of the unwanted noises, but also to add something pleasant, something that is particular for your brand maybe. Now, that's essentially starts with defining how should my vehicle sound. And then you can use tools like SimCenter Desktop Sound Designer to create that actual noise, to build on top of the already existing noise, combine these new sounds that you create based on how fast the vehicle is going, other elements that you can read from the vehicle, the conditions of the vehicle. You add sound on top of that to give the right impression to people. And those can then be implemented on the head unit of a car, and that's actually not so difficult. You already have usually a very nice sound system in the car. So in that same computer that manages your sound system, you can add these active sounds in there. So in essence, it's not a very complicated thing to do. Yeah. But it would make a vehicle nicer to be in. That is active sounds. Now, we have to also talk about more the basic things of a vehicle, such as wind noise. And wind noise is a very complex element in there. Wind noise is the noise that is created by the air flowing over the car. And typically, the windscreen wipers or the side mirrors, they will create turbulences in effect, that can create wind noise inside the vehicle. And on the one hand, you can do that with simulation. You can simulate these things, and we get quite good. There are even customers who almost can simulate a full vehicle in this sense. But also on the testing side, you see on the picture with the wind tunnel that you see there is a Mercedes-Benz wind tunnel, which is equipped with hundreds of microphones, which allow us to look at the sound that is created on the outside of the vehicle. And we combine that with scanners on the inside, that big black ball you see on the bottom, that's a 3D scanner for the inside of the vehicle. And we can correlate those things together. We can correlate the outside with the inside and really get a good understanding of how noise created on the outside is getting to the inside of the vehicle in order to evaluate wind noise. Wind noise, it's all body related, so we may need to talk a little bit about the vehicle body. Not just in the context of noise and vibration, but I use noise and vibration a little bit as the vehicle ear to talk about it. When we look at an electric vehicle car body, there is a heavy battery included. And this battery is connected to the car body, and it actually has quite strange effects on what the car body will do. It adds a lot of mass, but it also adds stiffness in particular areas. Similarly, for the electric motor integration, the electric motor, it is not anymore a low frequency generator of noise, but it creates high frequency noises. So the way we mount it in the vehicle and how we build the structure of the vehicle around that needs to be reconsidered. Similarly for road input, we had road noise being more important now, again, the engine being quieter. So the perception of road noise is changing. So we need to put in place some methodologies in order to evaluate car bodies, first of all from the concept phase, but later on also throughout the development. How do we deal with these, let's say, targets that we will be setting on a trim body level, how will we connect them to the structure of the car body. And this slide you may have seen, I mean, we put in place things like body concept modeling. Body concept modeling, which allows to create body concept models, clearly, and evaluate different concepts in that sense, look at how they link to trim body targets, and evaluate the full vehicle performance. And I give a very quick view of such a, what does this body concept modeling mean? Yeah? It's essentially, it starts from, if you want, the styling and the packaging of how the vehicle should be looking. Yeah, we already have a platform, typically these skateboards, and we're going to put another body on that. Now, that other body is, of course, needs to be configured in a way that it is the right shape. And what we will do is then create sort of a wireframe from that. Actually, the beam structure, the way the structural components of that car are built up. And then we use libraries of beams and joints that gives us typical cross sections, and we will populate those beams models with that. And this allows us to evaluate really like load paths through the structure. We can evaluate how loads from the motor, from the road, from other systems are traveling through that body and evaluate how that works together. When you have this body concept, yeah, that's one thing, but now we also need to look at how the body in white design properties, because that's sort of what that beam structure is, how that links to trim body targets. And for that, we have put in place methodologies to define what are the core, the really core trim body modes that we need to look at, link those trim body modes with the body in white modes, and then link those body in white modes to the actual target responses. And this is not just the modal frequencies, but also, for example, how the modal, the neutral lines of a mode are positioned. You can have the same frequency, but a different bending point in your body, and the vehicle will behave completely different. Example of where we have actually used that is on the on the Volvo XC90, where this modeling approach was used to develop the actual structure of the car body. Talking about car bodies, yeah, come to the last part of the presentation. It is about durability. Durability is another one of those subjects that is very near to our hearts. And with electric vehicles, the same issues as mentioned before for the body, added mass, a different distribution of the mass, the loads that are going to be different. Well, we add here a level of uncertainty. We cannot necessarily fall back on previous experience of how we have built car bodies. So we need to go again back to the thorough process of understanding the operational loads, setting targets, maybe getting accelerated drive cycles on test tracks from that, but also cascading that down to boundary conditions for virtual or real test benches. We need to also simulate these things, then bring it back together and run that on test tracks. So durability in this sense is a very important element, and we cannot neglect the fact that a car body or a car in general, when it becomes an electric vehicle, will behave quite different than a combustion engine vehicle. One example that I wanted to highlight here is our work that we do with the Nissan Technical Center in Europe, where they also implemented the complete start-to-finish process for durability engineering and use this also on the electric vehicles that they develop.